Manu Rangarajan with the Cornell Small Farm Program, and I'm really excited to be standing out here with Erica Frenay of Shelterbelt Farm. So Erica, tell us a little bit about your farm.
Shelterbelt Farm is in Brooktondale, New York. We're a very diversified farm. We raise grass-fed meats, duck eggs, soon chicken eggs, raw honey, and we have an orchard and a high tunnel. We produce some fruits and baby ginger and other crops in our high tunnel.
So we're standing out here with your flock of animals,
your flock and herd.
And everyone's busy enjoying this beautiful day. Tell us how you do this farm. What are your goals with the farm?
Well, our main interest is in soil improvement. So we view the soil as being like the earth's skin. And my love of farming, well, it probably started with my love of food, honestly, but when I learned that we could farm in a way that actually protected and benefited the soil, helped to build a healthy community of microbes and really alive, like all the life in the soil, and could protect wildlife like grassland birds, that's when I really became passionate about farming and decided that this is what I wanted to do.
Where'd you get exposed to this?
Well, my very first farm experience was when I was a student at Cornell. It was at the Dillman Hill Student Farm in its third season. I barely knew a vegetable from a weed at the time, but they had a volunteer-supported agriculture program, and I was newly vegetarian at the time, and I could pick vegetables. I would weed for 2 hours a week and then take home a big grocery bag full of vegetables, and that was the beginning for me. Right.
So these cows are busy here snacking away on grass. And I think it's amazing to see how beautiful the cover is when you look around the farm. It's really lovely. Tell us more about what are you doing with this grass and how are you managing it to keep your cows healthy and happy and your sheep moving along.
So we practice a type of grazing that has lots of different names. Sometimes it's called management intensive grazing or holistic planned grazing. And basically, the idea is that we are focusing on the soil and what the soil needs in order to stay covered, because as long as soil is covered, it's protected from the sun drying it out, it's protected from when raindrops fall, you know, if they hit bare soil, they can wash that soil away and create erosion problems. But whenever you see plants growing, I mean, a lot of the plants here are about probably 12 to 18 inches tall, they have at least that much root mass below the ground. And when the animals come through and graze off the plants actually slough off some of the roots below the ground, and that helps to feed the microbes in the soil. So we're really focusing on the health of the microbes in the soil, and there's a whole kind of chain reaction from there where if we keep the soil healthy, the plants will grow really well, which will feed the animals really well. We keep them pretty condensed and moving quickly across the landscape so that they're not ever grazing any plants too much, so they're not overgrazing, and they're distributing their manure fairly evenly across the landscape and basically fertilizing these fields.
How long did it take you to get this sort of pasture, and what was it like when you moved here?
Well, when we got here in 2010, this land had been sitting for 30 years unmanaged. So here in the humid Northeast, that means that it was pretty completely overgrown with brush. There were massive thickets of wild rose, lots of big honeysuckle. The soil surface itself was covered 50% with moss, and lots of undecomposed stems sitting on the soil surface. It was pretty wet, poorly drained, and acidic. Lots of strawberry growing, and some goldenrod, and a whole lot of knapweed also.
So these species weren't here when you started?
No. There was no grass and no legumes, like clover or goat's foot, trefoil or anything. And so
what did you do?
We started out by bringing because even if you keep animals that have a single stomach like that on pasture, they can't subsist solely on grass and forage. So you have to still supplement their diet with other things. So we were feeding them a mixed ration of corn and soy grains at the time. But we viewed that input, that we had to buy in the grain, but when it went through the animal's body, it came out as fertilizer. And so we would mow a small area and then run the animals through it really intensively, moving them every single day. And it was absolutely amazing to see the transformation from that really brushy soil covered with moss. So the digging action of the pigs and the scratching and pooping of the poultry just totally transformed it pretty rapidly, like in 2 years.
So when we look down here, I don't see any more moss. I mean, I don't see any sign of moss at all.
No, we still have places on our land. Because this, right now we're sitting on a leased field that was in slightly better shape than what our land looked like when we first got there. So we still do have some moss, but every year it gets better. Every year there's less knapweed, there's more grass and legumes. And so we have done a tiny bit of frost seeding of clover now. But in the beginning, in those first few years, we didn't do any liming, we didn't put down any seed. It was just what we were seeing come up was literally already in the soil, and it was just waiting for the right conditions to emerge.
So one thing that you've mentioned to me in the past is that the animals are a really important part of how you brought this farm back home. Can you talk a little bit about what animals do and how, as far as their impact physically, because I think people think a lot of animal agriculture as having a negative impact, and maybe that can happen, but on your farm, they've been a critical component of what you've been able to do here. How do you use them, other than the pigs and the pigs?
Yeah, well, my interest in using animals to heal land actually started when I was on a ranch in Texas many years ago, and I was taking a course on planned grazing. And at the time, I was vegetarian. I didn't grow up on a farm. I didn't have any knowledge about cattle. But I was able to see how this rancher, in a really dry place, was actually using animals to reverse desertification. So he was using the animals to cover more of the soil. And he had gotten a creek that had been dry for 20 years to start running again with water, because he was literally healing the water cycle by protecting and covering the soil. To me, that was a crucial moment. Like I was absolutely lit up by the idea that animals could have this impact. And so on our farm, the two sort of magical things that animals can do, ruminants in particular, ruminants are any livestock that has four stomachs. So sheep and cattle, they're creeping up now, they're turning towards this. Sheep and cattle have four stomachs. They're the only animals that can digest grass. The lignin in grass, you know, if we tried to eat this, we couldn't digest it.
My dog eats it.
Yes, our dog does the same thing. But cows and sheep, the grass can harvest sunlight and grow. I mean, this leaf is really like nature's solar panel. And so it's harvesting sunlight and growing, and the animals can then harvest this and turn it into protein, which can nourish people. The other, I think, sort of amazing, magical thing that animals do is they're like walking bacterial depositors. So inside their rumen, just as in ours, there are millions of microbes. And I mentioned that our soil seemed really dead and that the mineral cycle was stalled when we first got here. It hadn't had any fertility applied to it in decades, and the like stems and dead plants that fell on the soil surface, they weren't getting broken down because there was nothing to decompose them. There was no microbes, no fungus to decompose those stems. But every time these animals make a deposit from their back end onto the pasture, not only is it fertility, but it's also a packet of microbes. And as long as we can keep those microbes happy, then we can keep building soil and building more health in the soil. The other thing that happens is when the animals graze off the top part of a plant, these plants have about as much root mass below ground as they have above ground. And so when the plant gets eaten on the top, it tries to balance itself by sloughing off some of its roots. And those roots then get broken down by the life in the soil and provide food for the life in the soil. And usually we have the animals packed together a little bit more than this, and we move them very rapidly across the farm. And the other thing that they do, besides eating and pooping, is that they trample. And when they trample plant material, like stems, into the ground, that's also feeding the life in the soil. And so there's just a lot of synergies that they can create that we can't do. I mean, we can try to simulate it by mowing or something, but it doesn't have the same impact as if you're managing animals in the landscape. They're really essential to the health of the soil.
So grass and grazing. What would you want people to understand about grass?
I would want people to understand that animals that are raised on pasture, and if they're managed properly, can actually have an incredible beneficial impact on the soil health, and that it doesn't have to be in competition with environmental goals like protecting grassland bird habitat and things like that, but it actually can all work really well together if managed properly. The motto of our farm is food for your soul with love from our soil. And everything that we do on our farm, every enterprise, even though it seems like there maybe are a lot of random different enterprises, all of them fill a niche and are part of a farm ecosystem that we're trying to build that integrates with the natural ecosystem that protects the soil.
You once said something to me about soil, like it was the skin, right?
Yeah, I think it is. It's the skin of the earth. But it's alive. You know, maybe that sounds a little creepy, but it's a living skin, and it's what makes all terrestrial life on this planet possible. And so I just think it's fundamental and it's overlooked. I mean, we call it dirt. And there's a quote from Barbara Kingsolver that says, "Whatever you accomplish today, know that you first did it only because you ate something that came from dirt." And I really love that quote, even though she refers to soil as dirt.
So if you had a few things that you'd love for people to know about supporting your farm, what would you want people to support your farm, other than you?
Right. Well, I think people are often operating on information overload, and so it's really tempting to hear a soundbite about something and to just take that as though it's gospel truth and just believe that about farming or about anything. And so I just think that everybody who eats has a responsibility to know a little bit more about where their food comes from. And I'm not trying to tell you how to eat or what to eat, but just to know so that you're making informed decisions. I think that the world would be a better place if all of us had a little bit more knowledge about what we're putting past our lips every day. And I think it was that Thomas Jefferson who said, eating is an agricultural act. And so even if you think you're really far from and being involved, maybe you live in a city with high rises all around you and never see farmland, but because you eat, you are intimately tied with agriculture, and the decisions that you make every day about what to eat really impact the food system.
Ha ha ha.